A very good morning and welcome to the seventh meeting of the Criminal Justice Committee. No apologies have been received this morning. And the first agenda item is to agree whether to take item four in private. And this is to discuss the evidence we're about to hear on the COVID Recovery and Reform Bill. Can I also seek agreement that consideration of the evidence heard and draft reports on the bill should be taken in private at future meetings? Are we all agreed? Thank you very much. So I now refer members to papers 1 to 3, and today the committee is beginning its scrutiny of the justice provisions in the Coronavirus Recovery and Reform Bill at stage one of the Parliament's legislative process. We will hear from two panels of witnesses, and later in the meeting we'll be joined by representatives of the Howard League and the Scottish Prisons Service. However, first, I am very pleased to welcome to today's meeting Dr. Marcia Croft, Chief Executive of Scottish Women's Aid, and Kate Wallace, Chief Executive of Victim Support Scotland. And we very much appreciate the time that you have taken to join us this morning. So I intend to allow an hour for questions and answers. And as usual, I would ask members and our witnesses to keep questions and answers as succinct as possible. So when we are asking our questions, can I please ask members to indicate which witness you are directing your remarks to? So I know that both witnesses are familiar with how our online meetings work. If you would like to speak, you can let us know that you want to come in by typing an R in the chat function. So we'll now move directly to questions. And if I may, I would like to open up with a general opening question for both Kate Wallace and Dr. Marcia Scott. So I'll maybe bring in Kate first and then followed by Dr. Scott. So I note that both Victim Support Scotland and Scottish Women's Aid are supportive of a permanent change that will expand the use of virtual court proceedings. And I'd like to ask you, first maybe Kate, if there are any areas that you are concerned about in respect of the use of virtual attendance. So, for example, I know issues relating to digital access for vulnerable groups or people living with disability have been raised. So I'll come to you first, Kate, and just ask what your comments and thoughts are on the general provision. Over to you, Kate.
I mean, the feedback that we've had is that an overwhelming feedback that vulnerable witnesses in particular really value being able to give their evidence away from the courtroom. In particular, there's a lot of concerns about potentially seeing the accused or the accused's family. And we know from many, many decades of research that attending court is a traumatising situation for victims and witnesses often. So providing evidence and being able to give your best evidence out with a court setting that is a traumatising environment, we feel is a kind of overarching theme. Of course, there are issues around and assessing the suitability of giving evidence remotely for people who may have issues and challenges around accessing technology. I think the important thing to note here, though, is that those provisions are already in the vulnerable witness legislation that we've had in Scotland since 2004. So there is that ability to give evidence via a live video link out with a court building, if appropriate. So we would like to see a wider use of that, certainly. And yes, with an assessment of the support that somebody may need. However, the other thing to note is that the technology has moved on so much that the virtual trials that I've viewed, they're really that it's, you know, there are sometimes concerns about being able to use technology, but quite often most of the time that we've been supporting SCTS and others with the virtual trials, they've had somebody there with them, with the vulnerable witness. They would normally have a supporter there anyway through special measures, as you know. And that's helped overcome. But I think you know, from our perspective, we would want to see a trauma-informed justice system that gives people choice and control, and they can make that decision for themselves if they think that that is the way that they want to do it. It's not everybody that wants to give their evidence in that way, but certainly the overwhelming feedback that we've had is that it has really lessened people's trauma, and that concern that they've got about bumping into the accused or their family is just completely removed from them, which is helpful.
Thanks very much, Kate. I'll now bring in Marcia. Dr. Scott, would you like to pick up on that question?
I would. There's an echo in here. I'm not sure what but it's quite distracting. If there's a way to turn off somebody's mic. So the first thing I would say is that the legislation is deeply disappointing for us, in that a huge amount of work has gone in, and victim support was very much involved in this, that the trial of a virtual summer trials pilots in Grampian gave us a very robust report evaluation, and that indicated lots of pause, all the things that Kate said, and we sat on the board for that project. When we heard from victims and survivors in our network, they are overwhelmingly positive about feeling safer, giving better evidence, not having to trail their children all over Scotland in order to go to a court where their trial or hearing is postponed yet again. And it's got climate change benefits. So the one barrier left in the system that has been mentioned by the board and the Lord President was legislation needing to create, and I quote, in effect, a presumption for domestic abuse trials to go ahead in electronic form. So we would really hope, I speculate, that the reason we don't have that in this bill is there were concerns about cross-party consensus not being present. And I really urge the committee to weigh in constructively on this really important piece. Just to point out, the problem in the system at the moment is that defense agents tend to object to virtual trials, and so despite the possibility of thousands of trials going forward virtually during the previous 2 years, eight went ahead. So we really need this piece in the legislation.
Okay, thank you very much, Marcia. That's helpful and certainly food for thought for members. I'd just like to ask a quick follow-up question, and then I'll bring in Katie Clark to pick up some questions around time limits and criminal cases. But before I do that, I'd like again just to ask you both, Kate and Marcia, in terms of going forward and from the perspective of victims, and I think you've really touched on this, Marcia, just there, how well you feel virtual arrangements are working already. Clearly, they are with some challenges. And what in early course needs to change. So I'll come back to Kate and then I'll bring in Marcia. Kate.
Yeah, convener, sorry, I just wanted to come back on a point as well, if I can, about the earlier question. The point about kind of assessing the suitability of virtual methods of giving evidence, I think that the same applies to assessing the suitability of a court environment. So I just want to remind members that often our courts are not the most accessible of physical buildings as it is, and we often get complaints from victims and witnesses about acoustics within the courtroom, about physical accessibility arrangements. So actually being able to give your evidence virtually may well provide a much more inclusive approach, I guess, than a building-based environment at times. So I just wanted to say that. And yeah, in terms of your question about what needs to change, I think that, as I say, the expansion of what we would describe as a hybrid model. So, and as Marcia has said, a presumption of vulnerable witnesses being able to give their evidence virtually out with a court building altogether, if that is what they would prefer, is something that we would like to see happen really quite quickly and across the board. It is our belief that that you would have more attendance from witnesses, you would have less attrition, you would have better evidence from those people too, and that would all help with the backlog. The other thing that I think that we need to put in place, and I know there's moves being made around it at the moment, but it's a much better system around managing the actual business of the court. As you're aware, all committee members will be aware of the massive backlog, and I've spoken before to this committee around the impact that that has on victims and witnesses' mental health. But the other thing that's creeping up massively now is the number of adjournments. So the amount of times that witnesses are being asked to go to court and give evidence, and then last minute that is not happening, and then get being asked to go away and come back another day. Marcia will talk in more detail. I know she's got examples, as I do, of people who are being asked to come to court several times. And from a witness point of view, you know, that feeling that you've put your life on hold, you have to remember absolutely everything to try and give your best evidence, and then that rug getting pulled from under you last minute and being asked to come back at another, at that point, undisclosed time. You know, many, many, many cases now of people being asked to come back 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 times. And that whole process needs to be managed. That's one of my big concerns around, you know, coming out of this phase of the pandemic, is that less than a large number of trials for each court per day, when only one possible trial can go ahead, and citing all of those witnesses to come into that court, and then, as I say, these massive numbers of adjournments that are happening, it's going to become more and more intolerable for witnesses. So, for me, something needs to be done really quickly around that to manage that situation as we move out of this phase of the pandemic.
Thanks very much, Kate. I'll bring in Marcia.
I would say that probably needs quite a robust planning and implementation process that doesn't need assessment for anyone who's participating remotely. I think Kate would agree with me also that there's a huge opportunity for us to create a user-friendly, victim-friendly court system by creating places like victim support offices or CAB offices or women's aid offices in that are not more than an hour or two from where women live. Support can be made available there. The technology can be vetted by the court service. And I think there's so many advantages for creating these safe spaces for women and children that and that wouldn't be difficult, as the pilots have shown. So I think work on that, not rocket science, should happen immediately alongside the setting up of the virtual domestic abuse specialist courts in each sheriffdom. I agree that, you know, COVID has shoved Scotland into the 21st century, I think, and lots of other places, in terms of technology use. There's no going back on this. Let's use it and invest in it for people who have less access. So I think it's not impossible. It just requires political will and a bit of investment. The other thing I just want to echo is Kate's.
We can still hear you, I think, Marcia.
Yes, well, I just got a message saying that I'd been, I see, I was probably on two links. Forgive me, I do this all the time. You'd think I'd be better at it. Okay, I'm back. I can see you now finally, and there's no echo. I'll just give you a couple of cases, and I want to thank Barry McGowan for representing SWA on the virtual trials board, and also for help for sourcing these case studies from SIS. Just a couple sentences in each one. An incident was reported in May 2020. First trial date was August 2020, adjourned to January 2021, adjourned again to November 2021. At the intermediate diet, the trial was adjourned again as the scheduled date fell during COP26. The new trial date is scheduled for April 2022. The child witness was 7 years old at the time of the incident, and he will be nearly 10 by the next trial diet, which we hope goes ahead. Mm-hmm. On just a number, the trial has been adjourned 3 times, and on the 4th occasion, there was only time to take the mother's evidence. The child is required to come back to give her evidence in a few months' time. The mother broke down crying at this news. If it goes ahead, it will be nearly 2.5 years since the incident. I am pleading with the committee to understand the impact on victims and survivors, children and adults, of delay. And I think it's one of the elements of our system that existed before COVID, but was, as you know, greatly exacerbated by COVID. We have something like 40,000 cases in the backlog. 25% of those will be domestic abuse cases. It really requires some bold action here. And all of the path has been laid out for us. Let's not balk at the last hurdle. I hate to use these cliches, but I seem to be dropping into them.
I wonder if just on this issue that you're discussing in relation to time limits and delays, I wonder if I can, I'm just watching the time, I wonder if I know that there are members who'd like to ask some questions around that. So I'll maybe bring in Katie Clark and then Jamie Green, just to keep our discussion moving forward.
No problem.
Thanks, Marcia. Katie, over to you.
Thank you. And Marcia, if I could ask some questions on statutory time limits and whether you still support the longer criminal procedure time limits that were put in place in response to the pandemic and whether you've got any concerns in relation to them.
We do support them. We have obviously mixed feelings about that. I think in the line of, you know, what I've just been saying about the impact of delays on victims and survivors. But I think the problem is the system is pretty broken at the moment, and that's one of the safeguards we need to put in to make sure the cases don't get dropped.
I mean, do you have any concerns about them? Because as you know, the bill that we're considering is suggesting that we extend them, not permanently, but extend them for presumably a considerable further period of time. So do you have concerns, for example, about the period of time that accused can be remanded in custody?
As I said, we always have concerns. I think one of our biggest concerns about the remand problem, and I'm very mindful about the data coming out about numbers on remand in prison, that decisions about remand and about bail are seeming to be more, in part because of pressure on the system, driven by concerns about prison population, which I share. And a variety of other aspects of court problems, rather than victim safety. And we have always had concerns about that, but they are heightened by the situation during COVID. And I think Kate might support that. The issue for us, though, is what is it that can get the system working again? clearly, you know, scheduling 8 trials a day and then knowing that you're lucky if 2 are going to go ahead, you know, those are not good actions. So I think what we have to do is say we do support it until we see the system readjust, and then we would like it reconsidered as soon as possible.
Thank you. And Kate, could I ask you similar questions, whether you still support the longer criminal procedure time limits put in place in response to the pandemic and, you know, those measures being continued, and whether you've got any concerns from a victim's perspective?
Yeah, I mean, similar to Marcia, it's sort of with a heavy heart, but I think at the moment, because of the delays within the system, our biggest concern would be that cases would be timed out and victims would not see justice done. And having waited such a significant length of time with such a big impact on their mental health, as I've said before, that we really think that that is not something that can be tolerated. So we would see it as a necessity, an unfortunate necessity at the moment, certainly until, as Marcia says, the system is back under control, and that you know, the time delays are not what they are at the moment. So that, yeah, that was really what was lying behind some of our responses to the earlier consultation.
Thank you.
Okay, thanks, Katie. I'll bring in Jamie Green, and then I'll bring in Rona Mackay to move on to release of prisoners early. Jamie.
Thank you, and good morning, everyone. My colleague, Katie Clark, I think, actually has covered off this area quite well already. I think I get the impression that it's the necessary evil of the two options that we have. No one wants cases to time out, so there must be a mechanism by which they can be extended. But as you know, historically, they would have to go through an application process to be extended, whereas under the emergency procedure, there was an automatic extension. I guess what we're looking at here, though, is a bill to make some of the temporary features of COVID permanent. Therefore, would you have any concern that these extensions to 17 months, 18 months for solemn cases and another extension on summary cases, would you rather they were time-limited automatic extensions, and you would like to see them revert back to their original 11, 12 months? And at which point in the future do you think you would like to see that happen? And maybe Kate first, as you're on the screen already.
Yeah, we didn't support them being increased permanently, but certainly, yes, on a longer temporary basis. And the assessment about when they should revert back to pre-pandemic timescales would really be about an assessment, I think, about the system and how it's coping and how it's working. So that would be our view about that. We wouldn't want to see these time extensions, but simply because of the impact that the delay has on victims. I guess the thing that committee members will be aware of is that delay was already a problem in the justice system prior to the pandemic. We already had a large number of victims and witnesses who were really badly affected by the length of time that it took for their case to come to court and the delay in terms of, from their perspective, about giving evidence and the impact that they had on them. So for those reasons, we wouldn't be supportive of extending the timescales on a permanent basis simply because of the detrimental impact on victims and witnesses.
Thank you. Dr. Scott?
Yeah, I agree with Kate, essentially.
That's great. And my second question on this is, I mean, some people think even 18 months, albeit an extended time limit, is ambitious for some trials. We've just heard examples there of some that are taking way beyond 18 months. And indeed, if we assume that the backlog is going to take 4 or 5, perhaps longer, years to clear, given the volume, what do you think are the main causes of the delays to trials? Is it capacity in the system? Because we as a committee have asked the SCTS and the Crown Office on numerous occasions as to whether they think there is capacity in the system to deal with the backlog, or what more they might need to get through it more quickly. Or is it simply the nature of the processes by which we work with, i.e. even with all the will in the world, If we doubled the court capacity, if we doubled the amount of defence solicitors, or if we doubled the amount of Crown agents, we would still not get through it at the same rate as we could, because of the inherent nature by which the trials take place. What do you think are the main barriers to reducing the length of time that people are waiting? In other words, how do we clear that backlog quickly, but also fairly, so that each party is given the absolute right to fairness throughout the process?
You want me to answer?
Oh, I don't mind. I know it's a tough question.
If I can go first, I mean, you've heard some evidence from some earlier round table sessions. I think if you remember from, for example, the faculty advocates, I know the committee spoke around some of this as well. And for me, a really clear message that there's going to be a robust approach being taken in Scotland to make sure that cases are dealt with and that they are and that prosecutions are pursued. I think there's a number of things going on at the moment related to the pandemic, which are impacting on both the backlog, but also this kind of what I said at the beginning of this meeting about the adjournment level, which is really meaning that cases aren't getting cleared in the way that you would like. So for me, it's about a really robust case management system, a very strong message that cases will be carried through to their conclusion and their outcome in Scotland, and that is the process. Because I think you've got, you know, yes, you've got some people who are unable to attend court on the day because of COVID symptoms and the rest of it. But I think you have got a kind of overriding message that's going through, which is if you keep delaying and keep delaying and keep delaying, then perhaps your case will eventually be dropped. That's what victims really worry about. And the whole system is over the last 2 years, that's what they feel has really been going on here. And coupled with that, I think you've got some, as I say, some case management issues that I've spoken about, which make it really difficult, I think, for witnesses and victims to give their best evidence. There's not been the best communication and the best support put in place for people. And really, at the moment, you've got a kind of an approach which is, let's just, you know, list a whole load of trials and wait and see who turns up in the morning of court to see what ones are going to run. And that's not, I don't think, an effective way for us to carry on into the future, particularly not as COVID restrictions start to be removed within court buildings. I think you're going to see anxiety levels from people start to increase. And Marcia and I have spoken before about our concern that witnesses start to, the process becomes so prolonged and so traumatising for victims and witnesses that they actually start to drop out of the process. And we've got big concerns about that. I know that Sandy Brindley over at Rape Crisis Scotland does too. And also that then you've got a problem of people being less likely to report in future, which is something I think that we all want to avoid. So a kind of coordinated message across Scotland that the justice system is robust and it will continue, and we won't do what we're seeing in other parts of the world, which is, you know, dropping of prosecutions, dropping the cases, that kind of thing to try and manage the business. I think that would really help.
Thank you.
Thank you. Okay, thanks. Fine. Thank you very much. I'll hand over to Rona Mackay and then I'll bring Jamie Green back in. Rona.
Thanks, convener. Morning, Kate. Morning, Marcia. Can I ask you both, please, about the power to release prisoners early? I think you've both expressed opposition to this being to this provision in the bill, and you highlight the concern about the safety of victims, etc. I wonder if you could maybe give us some examples of how that might impact on victims, why you're concerned, and if there are any steps that you believe could be taken to allay these concerns. Marcia, can I come to you first?
I think we're very pleased that the first presumption, or, you know, the first actions on early release identified domestic abuse cases as an exception, a carve out not to be included. And we have some high degrees of skepticism about how well early release has worked so far. So it would be quite interesting to see the evaluation about whether and how often people who were released early wound up back in prison. Because what a terrible waste of the system's resources, if that's true, not to mention victim safety. But I think the pressures on the system are really pushing, I think, both sheriffs and the court service to think about how to reduce the pressures on the court service and on the courts rather than how to protect the victims in Scotland. And I really echo what Kate is saying in that we have to take action across the system, because unless we relieve the pressures on the courts and the sheriffs, no matter how well-intentioned the actions of the government are or of the parliament are, the system itself will default to delay because it protects people. You know, they'd rather delay something because there's no real consequence or accountability for that, rather than wind up in an appeals court, you know, being embarrassed and overturned. So, you know, that's a very much a layperson's assessment of how the system works. But I think it's very real that unless we make this work for multiple players, the delays will continue. The other thing I need to point out in terms of early release is that, you know, aside from domestic abuse cases, I do think the system needs to take a very close look at why we're remanding, and it should only be about public safety, you know, the safety of victims. But that's, you know, I suppose that's not a domestic abuse specialist informed opinion.
Okay, thank you. Kate, would you like to comment, please?
Yeah, I mean, going back to the emergency early release that happened during the kind of early stages of the pandemic, what we all saw as victim support organisations, so Women's Aid, Assist, Rape Crisis, was a massive upsurge in the numbers of victims who were contacting us, petrified that the perpetrator in their case was going to be released early. So we were all, you know, at that point, in terms of capacity, really struggling to try and manage people's anxiety and support them through that. And like Marcia, I'd be interested to see, we've heard anecdotally about some of the reports about what happened to those 348 people who were released early and during that wave and what happened afterwards. What I would really like to see is if we're going to go there again, is that we have a much more coordinated approach. There is information sharing agreements that were put in place very, very quickly. So it can be done between the prison service and every local authority in Scotland, as I'm sure you'll hear later on from Theresa Medhurst. That was put in place really quickly to make sure that support could be put in place for prisoners once they were released on emergency early release. But there was no equivalent done for victims in those situations. So there was no information sharing to make sure that there was wraparound for support for victims who were really traumatised by the thought of perpetrators in their cases being released early from prison. There was no thought or regard given to that whatsoever. And of course, victim support and others would be happy to work with whoever it is to make sure that the adequate support is put in place for people. Because what I really don't want to see is a return to that, that real anxiety that was around at that time. Yes, 348 people were released, but the impact was far greater on victims because they didn't know who it was that was going to be released, if you see what I mean. So we were all absolutely inundated at that time and reported it then. So that would be my plea, is that we put in place measures to make sure that information is shared around victims and we make sure that there's planning, safety planning, support planning put in place so that victims get the appropriate help that they need on when a perpetrator in their case is being released from prison.
Thanks, Kate. I think that's a really important point you've just raised. I'm happy to hand over to my colleague.
Okay, I think before I hand over to Jamie, I think, Marcia, were you wanting to come back in?
Yes, just very briefly, you'll be glad to know. that Kay can give you chapter and verse, but there have been huge difficulties with victim notification schemes, just to pick up on the issue about how the system responds. So clearly, you know, victims are not the clients of our system, but accused are. And I would say that for any releases, you know, early or not, we really, really need to take a quick, we know what the deficits are, and Kate has already referred to them, but we know that the system is capable of notifying victims, the question really in a timely manner, because they've done it to the local authorities. So the question is, how do we set the system up so that nobody is released unless the victim has had a certain amount of notice?
Okay, thanks very much. Thanks, Rona. I'll bring in Jamie, and then I think Russell Finlay is wanting to come in. Jamie.
Thank you. So just to pick up on this concept of early release, my question is two-part. The first part is, obviously, as you know, short-term prisoners in Scotland must be released after serving half of their sentence, and long-term prisoners may be released after serving half their sentence, subject to decisions by parole boards. My first question really is, what do you think about that as a concept? But secondly, what the emergency provisions of the coronavirus legislation did was give the Scottish Government the ability to release them earlier than those mandatory time limits. This bill, as I mentioned in the last question, seeks to make those provisions that were temporary more permanent features of the justice system. So I guess the main question is, do you think that's appropriate? Would you prefer these provisions were not in the permanent legislation? Because I think we all agree there are some good things that have come out of COVID in terms of reform to justice, and we've talked a little bit about those already. But this perhaps is one of those areas that we might not want to see as permanent features. So it's a two-part question. Maybe I'll start with Kate first.
Try and remember all the questions. Yeah, I mean, victims already struggle with the idea that people can be released after only serving half their sentence. That they do really, really struggle with that. I think that we're not in agreement that should be lessened in any way, because, as I say, victims already struggle with that. What we would be asking for is really clear communication with victims around exactly what how long someone will be serving in prison, and exactly what that looks like and what that means, and support being put in place for people, as I've said already, on release now, and that including victims as well. I think Marcia spoken about the deep concern that I've got about the victim notification scheme. I've spoken about it before at this committee, and I think until we solve those issues and solve those problems and get a proper trauma-informed approach to that, we're always going to have a challenge here, because it can be, you know, we can create a timeline around this as much as we want, but unless victims are actually given really good information in a supportive way, and supported around their own personal safety. I mean, one thing that I would bring in here is that, and I've spoken about this before, we extended our victims fund, if you remember, at the very beginning of the pandemic. So we're now providing about £300,000 a year, roughly, support direct to victims of crime where they've got an immediate financial need. Now, looking back at those figures at the beginning of the pandemic, that was more around household essential items. But more recently, so certainly in the last year, we are now being inundated with requests for security and safety equipment. That dominates the request for the Victims Fund by far. So that tells me that victims are really concerned about their safety and security in a way that they perhaps weren't at the start of the pandemic, or certainly not as much. So I think we need to bear that in mind too, just in terms of the questions that you've just raised. So sorry, I've forgotten the second part.
No, that's okay. The second part was obviously the ability to release people even earlier than halfway through the sentence was a temporary measure to deal with the public health emergency, the pandemic. But this now features in the bill to make these permanent powers. What's your view on that?
And I think, as Marcia and I have said before, I think it would be really interesting to dig out the figures of exactly what happened to those people who were released in emergency, early release, early, and see what happened with them and make an assessment from there. But our understanding is that did not go in the way that perhaps had been intended. And I think, from a victim's point of view, we certainly wouldn't be advocating reducing that timeline any further. I think it would be really, really challenging and really difficult for, in terms of what we've been speaking about around a robust justice system that keeps people safe. And in light of what I've just said, I think that's a really difficult argument to make.
Yeah, thank you very much for that. And just before Marcia comes in, unfortunately, the bad news is the numbers speak for themselves. Of the 348 people who were early released under the emergency power, 142 of them reoffended within 6 months. Now, I don't know the specifics of each of those cases. I'm sure that's information we could find, but I do suspect that a chunk of them will have related to domestic abuse or gender-based violence. So that is a worry. The reality is that whilst there was a public health emergency, we did have to release people from prison. They did go on to reoffend when they normally would have been serving their sentence. So the proof is in the pudding, unfortunately. But I'd be grateful if you do come across any anecdotal evidence of those cases to share that with the committee. And Dr. Scott, perhaps I could ask for your views on the same two questions, the first being the general concept of early release and the second about the emergency power.
I think I just want to underscore, because I think Women's Aid is often painted with an unfortunate picture about our feelings about prison population. We are not in favor of banging up people, and we don't think it's the only solution in domestic abuse cases. We do think it is the safest solution at the moment, because the other solutions to creating victim safety have not been implemented or invested in. And I speak here about robust electronic monitoring and GPS, use of GPS, intensive bail supervision and other things that are not on the agenda today. However, I feel like what the system is doing in a desperate attempt to deliver a good thing, which would be to reduce Scotland's prison population, is taking essentially a hammer to what requires a screwdriver. You know, I mean, the reality is that a sort of broad early release scheme is only needed because we're putting too many people in jail. Now, in the context of the previous early release, domestic abuse cases were not included in those cases on paper. But we all know that domestic abuse is far more prevalent than is visible in the system. And women and children are very unlikely, actually, to disclose and to call the police or to get the system involved, in part because of their treatment in court when they wind up there, but also because of delays. So I think there's a couple of things to remember. I would be very interested to find out about the extent to which domestic abuse offenses were part of the reoffending in those 140 plus cases, because, you know, my conviction is, you know, we still have women being told every day not to mention the domestic abuse in a civil case, you know, so because they're considered non-compliant or, you know, non-cooperative witnesses when they do. So I do think that a closer look at what happened in those cases would help us fine-tune the interactions. But the real problem is to fix the other delays in the system. And this also comes back to the question of how we feel about early release. We feel fine about early release for the people who shouldn't have been put in prison in the first place. Domestic abusers are not those people. And so again, it comes down to where is victim safety at risk? My suspicion is that if we started using that lens for looking at the prison population, we'd have a lot easier decisions and a lot more effective interventions. And just to point that out, I do know from what our discussions were going on with the problems with delays is that the witness attrition was already being observed by the Crown Office. And I think what we don't want is to reduce the prison population, as Kate said, by just making the process so difficult that people never engage with it. And the system had done some really good work at reducing time to court for domestic abuse trials prior to the pandemic. We have lots of research that says if you get a case to court within 8 to 10 weeks, then you have worse attrition on the defense side than you do on the complainer side, and you have better outcomes for everybody involved. And it was around 12 weeks prior to the pandemic, and now it's years. So I think that those are the kinds of things we need quick action on.
Thanks very much. I'm going to bring in Russell Finlay, and then I know, Fulton, you want to come in on this point. Kate, you happy for Fulton to jump in?
Yeah, thank you. Oh, you want to cool. And, yep.
Are you on this point then?
Yes.
Oh, yeah.
Yep. Sorry.
Thank you.
Yep. Right. Thank you. Hi to both of you. In respect of the early release emergency legislation, I mean, what we've heard today so far is that victims weren't told. You were left inundated with requests for information from people. We also know that, from what my colleague Jamie Green said, 40% of those who were released went on to reoffend quite quickly afterwards. We don't know the details of that. And I think, to me, it looks, again, like a complete imbalance. It's about a system that has little regard for victims. But I'll get off my soapbox and ask a question. One of the exemptions of those types of prisoners which this should not apply to is those who are subject to sex offender notification requirements. But I just wonder if that's quite a narrow, specific definition of those committed of sexual crimes, and whether, in fact, it could have been and may yet be used for prisoners who have been convicted of other crimes of a sexual nature in which the victims are primarily women and girls. And that's open to either of you or both of you. Thank you.
Kate, can I bring you in first? Kate?
I was actually going to hand over to Marcia. I think she might want to respond to this one.
I think first of all, I would defer to Sandy Brindley at Rape Crisis Scotland to address the sexual assault figures. But I do think it's worth pointing out that of the vast majority of victims of domestic abuse also are sexual assault victims. There just may not be a prosecution focused on that element of their experience. And I think that's really important. And I forgot my other point. Russell, can you remind me what the beginnings of that question were?
Sure. I mean, it's more quite a specific thing. The exemption is those who are subject to sex offender notification requirements. I just wonder if it means, therefore, that prisoners who've committed other sexual offences might not be exempt and could be released early, if we know that.
I think what I was going to point out is that that at least in the context of the larger, you know, world of victims who don't fall neatly into categories of sexual assault victim or domestic abuse victim or, you know, forced marriage victim, that our system is very much a blunt tool. So there's the early release of people who are not, you know, who are not perhaps on the sexual offender list does not mean that they are not a risk to the safety, which is what I think it comes back to your original point. But the other issue from our perspective is that, you know, I think the last time I looked at the data, which was prior to implementation of the new domestic abuse law, fewer than 1% of convicted offenders of domestic abuse wound up with a sentence over a year. So fewer than 1%. So what that means then really is that we have a vast majority of domestic abuse cases aren't going to be a problem with early release because the convicted offenders never wind up in prison. They wind up with community payback orders, which we think there are significant problems with.
Thank you. Yeah, if she'd like to answer, but I've got another very quick question that's maybe more directed towards Kate, if I could.
If I can just butt in just very quickly, I'm just watching the time. We've got just under 10 minutes left, so I'd appreciate succinct questions and answers as usual, Russell.
Yeah, this is more for Kate. It touches on the evidence from earlier on in respect of the applications from victims for security assistance. Can you expand a bit on that? Because clearly that wasn't why this fund was created. It was created to compensate people for what they've been through.
The Victims Fund wasn't created as a compensation fund. What it was created, we've had a Victims Fund in existence for over a decade, actually. And what it was supposed to be about was making sure that people who had no other financial means were not plunged into financial hardship as a result of being a victim of crime, so through no fault of their own. So the fund was always there. And what we did, though, was recognise that the pandemic would have an exacerbating impact. So that's why we increased it quite dramatically at the beginning of the pandemic, April 2020. But what we were seeing at the beginning was requests for example, food vouchers, clothing, people having to flee their home because of domestic abuse and only having the clothes on their back and their kids' clothes on their back and having nothing else. That, you know, so that was by far the kind of the majority of the applications that we saw at that time. But that has changed over time, and now the majority of applications have been made for security equipment and safety equipment. So things like CCTV cameras, that kind of thing, and that is dominating applications to the Victims Fund at the moment and has done for the last year. And yes, you're right, that is quite a different picture than we've seen before.
But why is this happening? Suddenly there's a sense that they're not protected and they need this additional help.
It would indicate so, yeah. I mean, I think we've got a bit more work to do in terms of trying to get feedback from people around exactly that. But yes, there's certainly seems to be a lot more people who are concerned about their own safety. That will be from a number of areas. We reported a rise in terms of the number of antisocial behaviour calls that we were getting from people who were, antisocial behaviour, hate crime. Obviously, we know that domestic abuse increased during the pandemic and in particular during periods of lockdown. So I think it's kind of all of that. And we're seeing that coming out in the applications that are being made.
Thank you.
Unfortunately.
Thank you very much.
Okay. Yeah, thanks. Thanks very much. I've got a couple of members wanting to come in just on this. So I'm going to bring in Fulton, followed by Pauline. And then hopefully, if we've got time, we'll move on to our next and final area of questioning. So Fulton.
Yeah, thanks, Gavira. So picking up actually back to Jamie Green's point, and it's probably a question for Dr. Scott. In terms of the domestic abuse offences, for people being released early, that is going to be really worrying for victims and hearing what's been said there. But in terms of domestic abuse sentences anyway, that you know, they're not usually, and I know Dr. Scott will agree here, they're not usually that lengthy in any case. So for me, it's actually about the rehabilitation of these people, you know, and it's a previous field that I worked in. And I wonder, for Dr. Scott, then, if we're talking about early release of specific groups of offenders like those involved in domestic abuse, would it be helpful if their early release was not only just highlighted so that the victims could be prepared, a point that Kate Wallace has made very well, but also could it be that you know, it was attached to some sort of work programme that's effective and works? And we know that, you know, recently the Scottish Government did invest further in criminal justice social work services, a very welcome move given the state of the pandemic. But I'm wondering what Dr. Scott thinks about that as a way to, you know, if there is going to be an early release of such prisoners.
I have to say that I have very little confidence in the ability of a work program to change the behaviour of a domestic abuse offender. There's really no evidence in the literature that that's going to be an effective intervention. We know we have the Caledonian program, and as you, I think we're referencing, the it's been expanded to about 2/3 of the local authorities in Scotland. But even if every local authority in Scotland had a well-financed, well-operating Caledonian program, they still only take a certain percentage of the convicted offenders referred to them because of the difficulty of delivering good outcomes with their program with quite a large number of offenders. So, and also I think, you know, it's not the only way to fix the problem. I do think that we need to have legislation that allows for longer sentences in summary cases. And I think one thing that points, an indicator that points that the system would like that is when we look at convictions under Section 1 of the new domestic abuse bill, so under the coercive and controlling behavior section of the bill, we see that it looks like the average sentence coming in under the summary court cases is 364 days. So we know that the sheriff and the courts are essentially using the maximum sentence allowed to them in these cases. And I think there's a piece, we need to have better information about what would be the appropriate limit on that. And I wanna just give a nod to the Parliament for passing that law, because I do think that the prosecution of the coercive and the controlling behaviors elements are allowing the courts to see much better the harm and trauma caused by domestic abuse and respond as best they can in that situation. The other thing I just want to point out is I think the equality impact assessment and the SPICE briefing for this COVID bill has failed to identify a number of really critical gender-related issues, but in particular the poor operation of the system, the fact that we have copious amounts of evidence that that COVID had a disproportionately negative impact on women, and yet we see nothing in this bill that tries to address the disproportionate harm that they're feeling. And I would guess that the resilience that women are feeling because their employment has been made more precarious because of COVID than men. And economic abuse has always been the single biggest concern for whether women are gonna be forced back into abusive relationships, that this bill really needs to reflect what we know and actually deliver on obligations under international agreements to deliver progressive realization of rights, or even just to protect the existing system where it's working well.
I'm going to hand over finally to Pauline McLeod. I think you'd like to come in, and then I'm afraid we're going to have to bring the session to a close, Pauline.
Thank you. I just have one question. Good morning, Kate and Martha. The committee have been asked to comment on the extension of court time limits, and you both expressed concerns about the level of adjournments that we previously had. Are you not more concerned that if the Parliament gives its authority to that, we could end up here again where we've been asked to extend it another 6 months? Maybe it's time just to say, just we need to add some pressure to fix the system. I have to say I'm deeply concerned about being asked to extend court time limits, given the evidence that you and Kate Wallace have given. And I'm concerned that we may be back here again if we extend these time limits for 6 months. I just wondered if you shared my concern. That was all. Thank you.
Hi there. Do you want me to come in? I see that I've been unmuted. Yeah, I mean, I can totally understand your concern around it. I think, though, that the reality is that there are so many cases now in the system that my concern around not extending time limits until the system has recovered and we've got it back under control is that cases will end up coming timed out, and that's the very opposite of what we want. So, you know, and victims are very, very concerned that they will not see justice done. So, yeah, I can completely understand what your concern is. However, I'm not sure that that trying to force the system to respond is actually going to give the effect that you would want. So yeah, it was just to say that.
And can I just finally, what if we are in the same situation in 6 months? Will you be seeing the same thing? That it's so broken that we have to extend it further?
I think the issue, when you look at the backlog figures, they speak for themselves, I think, in terms of timescales. There are no quick, easy solutions to that. And some of the solutions that we had submitted, as you probably know, our self-rape crisis, the Scottish Women's Aid and Assist, all wrote an open letter at the beginning of the pandemic outlining some of the ways that we thought the backlog could be reduced more quickly. Those have not been taken forward. So unfortunately, we are in this for a few years now, and there is no quick way, I don't think, out of it as it stands at the moment. So unfortunately, I do think that there is a situation where a temporary continuation of the extension of timescales is required.
Thank you very much.
Thanks very much. We've overrun a little bit, and while there are a couple of areas of questioning that we would have liked to have covered, I think time's been against us. So in that respect, I think we will ask some more questions and follow-up correspondence with the witnesses. So thank you very much for your attendance today. Likewise, if you feel that there are any outstanding matters that you would like to share with the committee, please feel free to do so in writing, and we'll take that evidence into account. So my thanks to both our witnesses this morning for attending, and we'll have a brief suspension for a couple of minutes just to allow our next panel of witnesses to come in. Thank you very much. Thank you very much and welcome back, everybody. I'd now like to welcome to the meeting Ms Emma Jardine, Policy and Public Affairs Advisor with Howard League Scotland, and Theresa Medhurst, Interim Chief Executive, and Alistair Purdy, Interim Director of Operations with the Scottish Prison Service, to welcome to you all. So I intend to allow around an hour and 20 minutes for questions and answers, and I'd like just to move directly on to questions, and I'd like to ask the opening question, if I may, and this is for both Theresa and Emma, if I may. And it relates to sort of developments around court business being undertaken by sort of electronic means. And I'm interested to know what your views are on the specific provisions within the bill that we're discussing this morning in terms of allowing flexibility for people to attend court proceedings remotely. So really, from your perspective, what are your views on the provisions that the bill outlines? So maybe come to you first, Emma.
Okay, thank you. Good morning to the committee. We have no objections. It's not our area of expertise, and we would expect that you would take evidence from the Scottish Courts and Tribunal service, but there's no reason why we shouldn't use some of the technological advances that have been imposed as a result of the pandemic into the future. We need to be careful that, as others have talked about, that this doesn't jeopardise or discriminate against those that find it more difficult to engage with the process by virtual means, and therefore it's something that should remain under constant monitoring, but we have no objections.
Thanks very much. Ms Medhurst, would you like to pick up on the question?
Thank you very much. Good morning, convener and members of the committee. So the two areas where I think there are implications for the Scottish Prison Service, obviously the virtual police custody service that is now in place has implications for us in two ways. We operate the escort contract, and so the staffing provision for custody and virtual custodies falls within our the management and of SPS, and therefore is our responsibility. So whilst we have been able to manage the levels so far during the pandemic, were there to be any increase to that, then clearly there would be resource implications, and we would need to consider what those resource implications would be. Secondly, in relation to the custody courts, because they are the last courts to be heard, then it does mean that we receive people sometimes later in the evening than we would normally expect. So that has implications both for our staff and for NHS staff as well, and ensuring that we admit people safely into our care during an evening. The other implication is obviously that there are other procedural court hearings have been taking place, and appeals are also regularly heard using virtual courts. Now, that has a positive impact in that the number of people who leave prison to go to court has reduced, and therefore the impact on those individuals has been minimised. But clearly, with the where there is anticipation that virtual courts will be used much more readily and frequently, then again there would be potential resource implications, not just in relation to our staffing and NHS staffing, but also in relation to buildings and the virtual capacity in prisons as well.
Thanks very much. That's an interesting update to hear. Mr Purdy, do you want to come in?
Yes, thanks, Convener. Just a couple of points to add to that as well. Sometimes the kind of workload means that the scheduling is sometimes quite difficult, and that leads to pre and post difficulty sometimes for the individuals to get legal support before and after. So that leads to some difficulty in terms of scheduling and then having that legal access pre and post.
Yeah. Okay, thanks very much. I'd just like to ask a quick follow-up question before I hand on to other members. The update in particular that you've spoken about in relation to the kind of positive impact in terms of things like less movement of prisoners in and out and the resource implications there. So these have clearly proven to be beneficial. What I'm interested in is this broadly being seen across the prison estate, and what more needs to be done to make this opportunity work as effectively as it can. So I'm going to come to you again, Teresa.
Thanks, convener. So, I mean, we are still obviously, both in relation to the pandemic mm-hmm. and virtual court business, feeling our way along. So there will be some bumps and glitches along the way. But what I would say to the committee is that you know, we do have really excellent working relationships with other parts of the criminal justice sector, and we work collaboratively together to iron out any issues or difficulties. So the benefits that have been exposed so far really have resulted in ensuring that those in our care who are not required to attend court, you know, for short hearings, that has been minimised, and the benefits then to that individual's, their well-being has been quite palpable. So that's been really positive. Sorry, what was the second part of your question?
Just really about what more, if anything, you know, you spoke about an early point and. Mm. Understandably, there will be bumps along the road, but I'm just interested in what, in your view, are perhaps priorities for developing and putting this this opportunity in place on a more permanent basis.
So, from a prison service perspective, mm-hmm. it would be helpful. And I know that Scottish Courts and Tribunal Service is clearly working really hard to better understand where the development of virtual court business is likely to land. And that would assist us in planning and preparing, particularly around those resource implications, because it's not clear yet how that is likely to impact in both size and scale. And what capacity we would have to be able to support virtual courts, because clearly prisons haven't been built with virtual courts in mind. And whilst you may think, well, you should require less room, actually, because of the way that courts need to operate in prisons, then there are really strict protocols around that we need to adhere to. But it is a welcome step into the world of virtual courts, and I can see many benefits, both in terms of minimising disruption to staffing levels, as well as ensuring that people who do not require to leave prison don't do so. I'm particularly thinking about, you know, distressed women or young people, you know, where it's minimising that exposure to that court experience.
Thanks very much. I don't know, Mr. Purdy, do you want to come in on that?
Just one point, convener, just to say that collaborative work is going forward with a sheriff principal for us to try and understand and marry the, you know, the two services together, so we can understand the planning going forward, so we can make sure we can maximise that opportunity for virtual courts to happen and minimise the impact on the individual, and obviously help support the criminal justice system in recovery.
Yeah. Thanks very much. That's helpful. I'll now hand straight over to Katie Clark, and then I'll bring in Jamie Green to ask some questions around statutory time limits. Katie.
Thank you. Good morning. And if I could maybe start with Emma. And basically what would be useful is if you could maybe outline your views on the provisions of the bill that would continue the temporary extension of the various time limits in criminal cases. If you could maybe outline your organisation's response to that?
Howard League Scotland would probably describe this, as the evidence given by Kate and Marcia, as a necessary evil. The numbers on remand, as you know, have increased from 16% of the prison population to the last figures we have, 27%. So, mm-hmm. as you know, these people have not been convicted of any crime. And we that's an important part of what we need to do. So it is a necessary evil in that the backlog is not likely to be cleared until 2023 or 2024. We agree, however, with colleagues in the Law Society, for example, who've highlighted some safeguarding concerns. And the Article 6 of the ECHR, everyone is entitled to a fair and public hearing within a reasonable time, and that's something we need to be mindful of.
And clearly the levels of remand in Scotland are very high, higher than the rest of the UK and higher than other comparable countries around Europe, etc. I mean, can you suggest any alternatives to how we deal with these cases and alternatives to remand?
Well, part of this obviously overlaps with the bail and release from custody consultation at the moment. So it's already been acknowledged that we need to do something about this quickly, and it needs to be something of significance. It's unfathomable that the remand rates are so high compared to England and Wales, as you point out. We need to be careful. We need to mark cases more quickly. We shouldn't be remanding anyone who is unlikely to receive a custodial sentence. We need to make better use of non-custodial bail options. They need to be adequately source-funded. We know the answers to these things, and I think the committee knows the answers to these things. It's a case of bold actions rather than bold visions, I think.
So do you think the alternatives are adequately resourced at the moment?
Evidence suggests that they are not, and we're aware of the fact that, of course, criminal justice social work are under huge pressure here as well.
Okay. I mean, if you were able to provide the committee with any further evidence in relation to that in writing, that would be useful. But if maybe I can move on to the Scottish Prison Service and really just ask sort of very similar questions in terms of what your views are on the provisions of the bill that it's being suggested should allow for the continuation of extensions of the various time limits in criminal cases and how that would impact on your organisation.
Thanks very much, Ms. Clark. So I think Emma's already outlined that, you know, we're now sitting at just over 30% of our population are on remand, and that includes those who are convicted awaiting sentence. That is a significant shift from 2020 when the pandemic first hit. We were sitting between 15 and 17%. What that means is obviously that how prisons operate is impacted on, because you've got a more significant... What we have experienced is a reduction in the short-term population. So at the same time as the remand population has risen, the short-term population has reduced. So it does mean that in terms of how we respond to the needs of the different elements of our population, whether that be long-term, short-term, it means that we have to pivot to provide the services then to a bigger remand cohort than we would have done previously. Although people are spending longer periods of time on remand, and I had anticipated we might experience some either disruption or unrest as a consequence, that hasn't actually proven to be the case, and to be honest, I'm not sure why, but there hasn't been any kind of pushback from those who are affected in any way that has created concerns, certainly from operational stability. I mean, clearly where people are on remand and the timescales within which they are likely to attend court are uncertain. that has an impact on their mental well-being and their health, and we're very mindful of that. So we have tried to put in place additional supportive measures in order to ensure that they are able to access either self-help or help through specialist support, such as our NHS colleagues.
So the issues are more to do with the numbers in prison rather than necessarily the time limits. The time limits being extended maybe have an impact on numbers.
The time limits are definitely having an impact on numbers.
I understand, yeah. And Alistair, is there any further points that you'd want to make?
No, it just leads to that uncertainty in an individual's mind about how long that the remand period is going to be, and that requires more support to be put in place at times as well, just working through that anxiety.
I understand. I perhaps could pass on to a colleague.
Thank you very much. I'll bring in Jamie Green now, and then we'll move on to some questioning around early release of prisoners. So, Jamie, over to you.
Thank you. My first question, good morning, just about good morning. My first question is to the Howard League. Do you feel like your organisation and any of the people that your organisation assists or represents have been adequately consulted in the process and passage of this bill?
I think we have had adequate time to respond in terms of consultation. However, I would make the point that until very recently, victim support organisations have often been at the table in terms of the formulation of legislation, which has not been afforded to organisations such as ourselves. I've personally written to the committee on a number of occasions to highlight things that otherwise I don't think would have been brought to your attention. And we are, whilst we are always careful to ensure that we're not talking about victims versus perpetrators, we all know that there is a huge degree of overlap between the two. However, until recently, I would suggest that perhaps we haven't had as loud a voice as we could have had in these types of discussions and in the formulation of legislation.
Thank you. So what are your main concerns about the bill, if any?
I think I'm probably jumping ahead a little bit, but in particular regard to emergency release, the original legislation was drafted in a very short period of time. And we are now in a position where we're being asked to extend that legislation without going back through it to correct some of the things which we believe are of concern. So, for example, and in the evidence you took in the session prior, there were questions around exemptions and so on, whereby nobody has raised the issue of why was the legislation not drafted on a vulnerability-based model. I think we forget here that the 348 prisoners who were released early, these were people who were nearing the end of their sentences. They had only been short-term sentence prisoners within 3 months of their release date, and there were the exemptions we know of. Therefore, all that happened in reality was that people who were already going to be released were released a little earlier, some only by a day or two in the three tranches of release. We question, why does the legislation not include children? Why does it not include the most vulnerable, the disabled, pregnant women, for example? So we question whether the scrutiny is not necessarily appropriate, and we're talking about using coronavirus as a means of talking about time limits for existing legislation rather than giving ourselves the breadth of time to re-examine some of that legislation if it wasn't drafted in a way that suits today's environment.
And perhaps that's that we will come back to the issue of prisoner release. Other members have questions also. But coming back to time limits, because it is a technical matter and the bill deals with it on a technical level, perhaps I can ask both of you, if necessary. I think there is a general understanding of why there was an extension of statutory time limits, both for trials and in the more direct case, remand, which has direct effect on the prison estate. But they are quite stark extensions, you know, the jump from 80 days to 260 days, 110 to 290, 140 to 320, that's nearly a year. You know, these are marked differences, and they were emergency and they were temporary. Of course, this bill does seek to retain the power to make them more ongoing features of the justice system. Do you have a view on that? Should we, I mean, is it right that they should, that they're in here? Do we still need them, given that the First Minister announced yesterday that the majority of COVID restrictions will be dropped next month? Why should these become permanent features of our justice system?
I don't think they should. Hurry League Scotland does not think they should be made permanent. It's probably worth pointing out, of course, that there was already a backlog. It's not just as a result of coronavirus. It's probably an opportune moment here to remind ourselves what the conditions of those held on remand are as well. You correctly point out that this is a big jump in terms of number of days. Remand prisoners, despite the best intentions of the Scottish Prison Service, who are in an incredibly difficult position. We're at 94% of pre-pandemic levels in terms of prison population. And those on remand, as we know, are not... there is no requirement for them to attend work parties, for example. The uncertainty that's already been pointed out means that we are at a point where the Committee for the Prevention of Torture, we're at that stage. We're at legal solitary confinement stage for some remand prisoners when they are kept, they can be kept in their cells for 22 plus hours a day. And that's something we must be very mindful of.
Can I ask the Prison Service what effect this rather elongated extension to remand time has had on you? And do you have a view as to whether these seem proportionate and necessary measures to make permanent features?
Thanks very much, Mr. Green. So, as I mentioned earlier, as part of the justice sector response to the pandemic, we've been working very closely with colleagues across the justice system to better understand both the pressures and the impact of the restrictions as we have worked through the different phases of the pandemic. And whilst I understand why Emma's saying, you know, this shouldn't be the case, clearly we are in quite unprecedented circumstances, so I can understand the pressures on the system are such that this has been implemented initially and then obviously moves now to more permanence around those arrangements. The impact and implications for us are really around the population profile and how we manage it. Remand prisoners are to be kept separate from other cohorts of prisoners. Our buildings are quite fixed assets, as I'm sure you'll understand, and trying to adhere to that separation, the legal requirements for that, while supporting increasing numbers, does present challenges, both in terms of access to services and supports, as well as just ensuring that people are given the right support at the right time.
They're not just challenges, it sounds like they're almost breaching international law here. I mean, for example, I refer to the paper from HMIPS, who stated that whilst staff prisoner relations and the tolerance of prisoners to a very restrictive regime have been positive to date, perhaps not in every case, but overarching, but the continuation of heavy restrictions risks an adverse reaction. I mean, that's a very real reaction. We've already seen the consequence of that. We already know of incidents of attacks on prison officers, for example. So the levels of tension, you know, there's a distinct possibility that these could rise. Do you think there's any sense amongst the prison population that why is the wider public and the wider world moving forward, but we're still being imposed restrictive measures that were under the emergency?
So, Mr. Green, can I just ask, in relation to the attacks on prison officers, which, what are you referring to? Just
well, have there been any?
Sorry?
Have there been any?
Right, so you're asking me the question.
Yeah, sure, sorry, I should have made that clear.
So, well, we do have assaults on staff, but the reasons for that are complex. I don't have that information to hand, but I can certainly provide that to the committee if you so wish. In relation to the response from our population, it has been absolutely incredible. The cooperation and collaboration in respect of moving through the different phases of the pandemic has been outstanding, both from our staff and those in our care. And they have welcomed the fact that, and positively commented on the fact that we have made every effort to try and keep them safe. Would we want to operate in such restricted conditions on an ongoing basis? Absolutely not. But as we move through the different phases of the pandemic, we have been able to reinstate and realise more access to purposeful activity. And hopefully this year looks like it's going to be more positive. We should be able to do even more this year in terms of restoring what would be akin to a normal regime.
Okay.
Okay, thanks very much. I'll hand over to Rona Mackay now, and then I'll bring in Russell Finlay. And if I can just remind members, I know this, everything that we're discussing is important and relevant, but if we can just keep our lines of questioning to the provisions in the bill, I'd appreciate that. Rona.
Thank you, Convener. Yes, good morning. Can I ask Emma, firstly, it's about the power to release prisoners early. Are you in favour of continuing on a temporary basis the current additional powers to release prisoners early? And if so, what are your reasons?
Yes, we do ask that these are extended, but not on a permanent basis, because at the moment, as I mentioned earlier, I don't think they are broad enough. I think they require further scrutiny. We should be looking at it from a vulnerability human rights based model, and therefore until the legislation is looked at again, we would not want this to be made permanent. However, there is one other important point to raise, which is that the idea of early release of prisoners is also something that occurs in other legislation. So in the bail and early release consultation, there is the proposal made that there could be an early release of prisoners on the basis of flood or infrastructure problems within a prison. And I think it's probably worth pointing out here that we're beginning to use legislation. Now, we are potentially at the point where we're using legislation in a way which was perhaps not expected, and that is incorrect. So what I mean by that is that the lack of funding, capital expenditure funding for the prison estate, we're now using legislation on the basis of, for example, should HMP Barlinnie or parts of HMP Barlinnie be ruled to be inhabitable, then we can use the legislation to release people on that basis. And that's a very slippery slope.
Okay, thank you. I was really interested in your points about human rights and vulnerability-based modelling. Your letter, you're concerned about the conflict between the UN Convention on the Rights of the Child and Articles 2 and 8 of the ECHR, and HMIPS are concerned about children and young people as well. So can you maybe just sort of reiterate that, you know, you said that you wouldn't be in favour of the powers being permanent. Would you be in favour of them being permanent if enough scrutiny was done in this regard?
I think it would be too early. I mean, I think in honesty, it's too early to know, because we wouldn't know what legislation we were expecting to be made permanent. But at the moment, there are significant flaws. There hasn't been a children's rights and wellbeing impact assessment. And oddly, with regard to the Coronavirus Recovery and Reform Scotland Bill, the reason given for that not having taken place was because it should be covered by legislation, by other legislation, the emergency release legislation. Mm-hmm. But children are not included in that legislation. Therefore, there is no impact assessment having been done. And again, I remind the committee, I expect you already know, we are holding 14, 16 and 17-year-olds in prison. 11 of those are on remand. So 79% of children held in young offenders institutes at the moment are on remand.
I think that's a really important point. Thank you. Can I move to Theresa Medhurst, please, and ask you this, on that issue, maybe your thoughts on it, on the vulnerability human rights issue. And how would you respond to sort of general concerns that the use of early release can threaten the safety of the public and the sort of general unease of the public at the thought of this actually being happening on a permanent basis?
So the regulations around early release were obviously developed by Scottish Government, and it was in response to the effect of the pandemic and the challenges that we were facing at that particular time. Our single cell occupancy was as low as just over 60% because of the population pressures. And clearly, when you are enforcing restrictions, which we were in terms of outbreaks and isolation, then the smaller the number of people who are affected by that, the better. We had moved to what we called household bubbles, so trying to cohort individuals together in smaller groups to keep them safer and minimise the likely impact of spread of the virus within prisons. But in order to do that more effectively, then clearly single cell occupancy was at a premium, and for those reasons it was decided to invoke the emergency early release arrangements and release a number of people back into the community. And that did result in our single cell occupancy moving up to around 84%. So it was much easier for us to manage the risk of infection and the spread of infection within prisons at that time. Of course, I understand the concerns of the public about people being released. But as I recall at that time, around the emergency release arrangements, the concerns that we were receiving from the public were mainly around people moving from prisons into the community and taking the virus with them. It wasn't actually about other types of offending that might occur. And at that time, although we did have outbreaks, all of our processes and protocols would manage and mitigate any risks of anyone who was infectious at the time of release.
Thank you. Could you maybe just address the point that Howard League make about the vulnerability of children and young people and whether more scrutiny should be done on that? Are you happy that, well, it's not been done, but, you know, what are your thoughts on that?
I suppose it's really for a matter for government to respond to, because it is government legislation rather than SPS. We apply the legislation as it's designed and indicated. But in response to, you know, having young people, children in custody and vulnerabilities in other groups, what we did, particularly around virtual visits and mobile phones, was prioritise those establishments with those individuals in custody in order to better support them, recognising those vulnerabilities within those populations.
Okay, Thank you. Thanks,
Okay, thanks very much. I think before I bring in Russell, Pauline, I think, do you want to come in with a follow-up question on this?
Just on remand accommodation and... Okay. Is it okay? Good morning. It's still good morning. First of all, Theresa Mertens, I just wanted to confirm that you did say the remand population is now at 30%, where the figure that we previously used was 27%. And I appreciate that the prison environment is just to manage the situation that you're given in terms of the legislation. But do you not think it's inevitable that if those are now the figures, that remand prisoners will be held in more difficult conditions if we extend this legislation?
As I said earlier, what we have seen is a reduction in the short-term population. So, 7,550, which obviously is still above our design capacity. But it does mean that we, as we reinstate services and support, we will be able to pivot more to those on remand because we have got a reduction in our short-term prisoner population. So we can look at the kind of facilities and support arrangements. Some establishments already have those on remand offered work placements. It's not consistent across the board, but some do. Some are also able to offer education. Berlini, for example, offers education to those on remand. So there are... what we need to do is look at a consistent offer to those on remand, particularly if they are going to be a larger feature of our population going forward.
Thank you. I would certainly appreciate if the committee could be kept in touch with that, if indeed the Parliament does extend those regulations. Emma Jardine, I wanted to ask you further to what you've said already to the committee. You will be aware, I just wanted to put on the record, that the time limits on remand now, if we extend it, will be from indictment, the 80 days will be extended to 260 days. Time on remand for pre-trial hearings will be 110 days to 290 days, and time on remand until trial will be 140 days to 320 days. I mean, I wondered if you would agree that those figures are pretty stark for any parliament to be asked to extend powers further, given that those will be the minimum in which they... And I wondered if you, just finally... The rationale for this is that conducting large numbers of individual hearings on applications to extend time limits or renew adjournments on a case-by-case basis. So the reason we've been asked to consider this is to prevent the Crown, or perhaps Defence as well, asking for extension and time limits on a case-by-case basis. So it will all be automatic. How concerned are you or not about what the Parliament might be asked to do here? In terms of the impact that that will have on the... Would it not be better, for example, just to do it on a case-by-case basis and then there'll be less people impacted?
I'm not sure that this is my area of expertise. Right, okay. And I think, with respect, this is probably a question better posed to the Scottish Courts and Tribunals Service than myself.
You don't think there would be some human rights implications? Because you have already said to the committee that you think we're in danger.
Yes.
Or perhaps not complying with the Committee of Punishment and Torture.
My apology, you're quite right. Yes, I mean, we are in danger of breaching Article 6. And I repeat, everyone is entitled to a fair and public hearing within a reasonable time. In terms of what those time limits are, that is probably a little bit out with my area of expertise. Okay. But yes, you're absolutely right to point out that there are serious human rights safeguards being called into question by this. And you are, I don't envy your position in being asked to pass this.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. It's a question for Teresa, and you touched on this earlier on. Now, many people will be concerned about the ability of a government to release people early from prison, and we've heard all sorts of evidence about what happened. Now, given this is a coronavirus public health requirement, this is the whole purpose of it, you talked earlier about mitigation in respect of prisoners who have been released. Were they all tested for COVID prior to their release?
The testing regime wasn't in place at that time, Mr. Finlay, so testing wasn't available. I looked to Ali, but no, I don't think it wasn't. Testing wasn't available, but clearly people were asked questions prior to release about their health, and that happens regardless of whether they're going out for early release or not. And where we had, where there was an indication that somebody may have had COVID, then clearly we would have tested that individual, but also put in place the mitigations to ensure safe movement out with custody.
So at the height of the pandemic, you're being asked by the government to release prisoners. They're not giving you the means in which to test them for COVID. We know that 40% of those released went on to commit further crime, and it's probably a safe assumption that some of them went on to infect people with COVID. We just don't know. Is that true?
I'm not a public health professional. We could only manage the conditions that we were faced with at that time. We worked very closely with public health consultants and experts to put in place protocols that would protect as far as possible. But at that time, in reality, the numbers that we are talking about were still fairly low within custody. I'm going to ask Ali to come in at that point.
Thanks. Just to answer that, Mr. Finlay, the testing regimes and pathways weren't in place, I think, across the country at that time. But what we did to try and mitigate against it was to make sure that if the 348 people back to local authorities had information regarding the pandemic, knew where to go in terms of the symptoms, if they had that at the time, and how to approach that and make sure that the public health message was carried with the 348 people into the community, and making sure that the links were there and they knew where to go within their local authority area should they have any health concerns. But the extent of the infection within the establishments at that time wasn't known.
Okay. And going forward, have you had discussions with the government about if this is enacted again, that testing would take place?
I don't think we have at the moment.
We haven't, but just for the committee's information, we have several testing pathways already ongoing within establishments just now. That's from day one on admission and day 7 and 8 after that. We have universal lateral flow testing available for our population. We have PCR testing for our staff. We have lateral flow testing for our GOAMI contractor and our private prisons. We have a pathway for testing for visitors coming into the establishments as well, from our visitor centres and from our reception areas, and as well as anyone who's symptomatic will automatically go under a PCR testing regime in isolation. So we have several pathways now across the prison and out with the prison that we would utilise should it be enacted again.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much indeed. I think if that's all the questions that members would like to ask on the bill, I'd like to thank you for your... do you want to come in?
Apologies, I was looking at our schedule of questions and I was on prisoner release. Can I just sort of just... that's what you've said is very welcome, Mr. Pardy. Can I just double check that all prisoners, irrespective of whether it's early or planned or due, all prisoners are tested before release from prison? Is that a matter of course, or are they then tested when they go into the community as a matter of general public health?
You know, similar to community, it's testing is voluntary, so we can't compulsorily test everybody on release. Mr. Green as well, but the testing is offered, so universal lateral flow testing is there 7 days a week for people, so we encourage those who are either on transfer or on release to participate in that lateral programme that we have in place, but it's not mandatory, so we can't compel people to do that, going back into the community.
No, I understand the implications of that. And Ms. Smithers, just on the point, because obviously the can I ask what the criteria was for coming to a decision about early release? And I'm not asking that just for the sake of looking backwards, but because the bill before us that we're talking about in this session means that it could happen again. Would you assume that the criteria that you used last time, which seemed to be in your one of your earlier answers, largely around the ability to confine people in single occupancy spaces, or which was as a result of population versus capacity, what criteria did you use for the people that were early released, and would you use the same criteria again, and if not, what would be different?
So the criteria that was used for early release was set by Scottish Government because it's their policy. And as I said earlier, it really focused on trying to reduce the population at a time when we had people having no access to physical visits. We had reduced the cohorts that people were able to associate in to numbers between 12 and 30. They were getting limited, individuals in custody were getting limited access to services and supports because we had responded in the same way to the pandemic as was being expected in communities. So most services were down or being delivered in alternative ways. And therefore, knowing and understanding those pressures on individuals and the requirement for us to ensure that we responded in a measured way to the mitigations that were required to stop the spread of infection in prisons. And the predictions had been that people would die from COVID in prisons, not in tens, but in hundreds, and that hasn't happened. So I think that the purpose of it was to alleviate the pressures on the system and ensure that we could apply the measures and the mitigations that public health colleagues were putting in place, along with governors, to manage the pandemic in a proportionate and justifiable way in order to ensure that we kept the legitimacy of what we were doing with our population.
I guess my only question is, that was a reactive measure to an emergency, as we talked, there wasn't even a testing regime in place. So you were dealing with what you had within just months of the pandemic starting. We're 2 years on from that now, of course, in a very different world. And these are measures which are being proposed for the future, not for the today. So I guess my original question is that in that respect, what should be the criteria that is used? Because if it's only about the pandemic or the health situation within the prison or the population or how many people are in a cell, and less about the type of prisoner or how long is left in their sentence, or you know, when we have to go back to the government and say what we think is right or wrong, from your point of view, what sort of people were being released, and was it entirely appropriate that they were released early? Indeed, would we do something differently next time? Because ultimately, the government will have to rewrite the rules for future pandemics or variations of this one.
So, in terms of the release mechanism that was applied in 2020, it did alleviate the pressure on the prison service, and we hadn't experienced population levels similar to that since 2006. So it did allow us the space and time to develop our response, to make it more sophisticated, and to put in place mitigations that supported people in a measured and proportionate way. Were emergency release to be applied again, I think that would be a matter for Scottish Government to determine, depending on which circumstances arose at the time.
Yes, thanks.
Thanks very much. Thank you again for that. So I'd like, if I may, to move on for the final part of this evidence session to the forthcoming SSI that is coming forward this coming Friday. We understand that the Scottish Prison Service intends to seek a further 6-month extension to powers for governors to respond to the coronavirus pandemic in prisons and young offenders institutions. Now, obviously, this isn't something that we've just been covering off in the COVID Recovery and Reform Bill session, which was the main subject of today's session. However, the committee would like to take the opportunity to ask some questions about the proposed extension, if we may. Now, it's very helpful that we have had sight of copies of correspondence from the HMI for Prisons, Howard League, and also the Scottish Prison Service in relation to the SSI. So if we may spend maybe about 20 minutes or so just asking some questions about the SSI. And if I could maybe just start with maybe a general question for you, Ms. Medhurst, really just to kind of outline why you feel the extension is necessary, and does the extension reflect the latest public health sort of advice that we are being given? So I'd maybe direct that initially to yourself, Ms. Medhurst.
Thank you very much, Convener. So in relation to the public health advice, there is a set of guidance which is bespoke for prisons that we follow, in addition to the changes that take place through Scottish Government announcements. And we have complied with that guidance because we have been designated as complex residential setting, which is not the same, obviously, as hospitals and care homes, but not the same as other types of settings either. We are closed, obviously closed institutions, and therefore in 2020 in particular, when we were moving through the initial stages of the pandemic, it became very clear that what was required was bespoke advice and guidance for prisons. So we have continued to follow that guidance. We do so still today. And that's why we consider that in relation to managing both the risks, the well-being, the safety and health of those in our care and our staff, then the measures that we wish to continue are proportionate. I would hope that as we move through this year, the requirement to impose any of those restrictions is minimal at most. But we are still experiencing outbreaks in prisons. We are still experiencing impact on our staffing levels. And therefore, these restrictions, as we have moved through the pandemic in relation to both the public health advice and the guidance and our ability to operate as effectively as we can, these restrictions are those that we consider are proportionate to retain.
Okay, thanks. I don't know if you want to come in at all, Mr. Purdy, with anything to add.
Yes, Convener, just to say that we've used them really sparingly, but at times through, I think, the three variants that we've really seen from Kent, and then we went through to the last one, the Omicron, we found that to use the measures allowed us to keep the population safe, visitors safe, and try and get that balance between public health, human rights, and moving our prisons through the recovery. So it's really useful, and it was a tool that governors and teams were able to use very sparingly since the last time the SSI was extended.
Thanks very much. I'm going to open up questioning to members. I'll bring in Colette Stevenson. You've been waiting patiently online. So I'll hand over to Colette, and then I think I'll just work around the room and ask members if they'd like to ask anything. So Colette, over to you.
Okay, thanks, Convener. It was really just to touch upon the SSI in terms of what Wendy Sinclair-Gibbon had raised as well, and the concerns that they've got from the Inspectorate of Prisons. One of the things that was raised was that it wasn't, the amendments do not provide clarity on where decisions are taken in terms of the impact it's had on prisoners, like access and visits, purposeful activity and recreation, which could have a huge impact, you know. And as well as that, the communication as well and how that's, you know, implemented. One of the suggestions was that there should be, rather than having a central oversight here, there should be, you know, individual governors in charge, put more planning and decision making in there. Is that something that you have considered? And if so, is that something we could put in the SSI? And my concern again, and I've raised this before when this has come up before about the human rights under OPCAT for the people in prison as well. Thanks.
Who would you like to address that to, Colette?
Oh, sorry. If I could put it to Howard Leake and also Teresa as well.
Howard Leake Scotland certainly has concerns over human rights legislation, and we concur with Wendy Sinclair Guybin as the Her Majesty's Chief Inspector of Prison with this regard. It has been euphemistically put that there are tensions with Articles 2, 3 and 8. We would support that perhaps less euphemistically than that. We don't have transparent, clear reporting, as you point out. There are other jurisdictions where time out of cell is measured and reported on. The prison rules, the process itself hasn't allowed for much scrutiny. In this consultation response, we were asked not to reiterate things which we had brought up in the previous consultation response. And in that consultation response, it asked for gaps in provision, which we identified and now are not able to question. There are Council of Europe principles which we are not necessarily adhering to, and what we are asking is that anything that a governor in charge does should be reported on by some independent means so that we know when the proportionate measures are introduced, why are they being introduced, how long are they being introduced for, and who has central oversight of that. So we very much agree with Wendy Sinclair Guybin on this matter.
Yes, and first of all, convener, and then I'll bring in Alistair, if that's okay. So I think with regards to the question around independence, so the Chief Inspector of Prisons clearly is an independent body and they provide scrutiny and oversight across all Scotland's prisons. The Chief Inspector can appear at the door of a prison at any time and ask for access to anywhere within the prison, so that's within her role and remit. There's also the independent monitoring or independent prison monitors who are also allocated to different prisons who work under within the banner of the Chief Inspector. And again, they provide on-site scrutiny of the conditions that are being applied at any given time. The reporting arrangements for governors, so it is only within the prison rules, it is only a governor who can apply these restrictions, but there is oversight from a headquarters position, and that reports directly into Alistair. So do you want to say a bit more about that, Ali?
Yeah. Convener, just anyone out with an individual decision, if the SSI was applied to impact on larger parts of the prison, does come through and it seeks permission from myself to be able to do that, and it has the justification on it. It's usually backed up by IMT case conferences that would make public health recommendations for that to be followed. It will also state on it the length of time that is proposed, and it has to be actively reviewed on a daily basis. We do that, and that's happened on all the occasions since we renewed it since October last year, so we would look at that. And on all of the occasions, the measures have been stepped down and set aside quicker than we expected them to be. But we also have a national coronavirus response group that governors are linked into, and that is the national body that takes public health advice, it takes NHS colleagues' advice, and it's a multidisciplinary team that's linked into local coronavirus groups within establishments. Again, they replicate that, so they have the information, they have the infection rates, they have the key picture that allows the governor to be able to take those decisions, and that, in effect, gives the governor that position to then make that recommendation through myself to have that authorised, the SSI.
Okay, thanks very much. That's helpful. Colette, do you want to come back in at all?
Just quickly ask Alistair, really. So there obviously is, you're saying there's a good flow of communication in terms of when any governor chooses to implement that. Have you looked at, when you have implemented it in the past, the impact it's had, particularly on young people, remand prisoners as well. What's the longest, and is there any particular state that it's been prevalent, more so than others?
Yeah, just to pick that up, it's actually been spread right across the estate, so there hasn't been specific pockets. So, but to give you an example of some of the recent ones, some of the restrictions were placed on visits and recreations for 3 days within one of our establishments, and that's because the four wings within the area had been deemed by our public health colleagues to have to be mass tested, so we had to do that. And other areas have extended for 2 weeks over the last Omicron in terms of visits, so that was a significant staffing reduction levels. So it's varied from 2 or 3 days to a month at times in recent times that those measures would have to stay in place.
Colette, are you happy with that? If any final follow-up questions?
Just quickly, sorry, convener. It was just on the fact that, and I note as well that there has been challenges within the prison estate in terms of staff absences. I was just wondering if maybe Alistair or Teresa wanted to come in here as to what is the current level of staff absences at the moment, and is there anything, being done in terms of recruitment or to sort of kind of see what you can do to rectify that?
Thanks very much, Ms Stevenson. So we monitor our absence levels on a daily basis, and we disaggregate the absence levels by COVID and non-COVID absence. So as of yesterday, I think we had seen a slight increase again, just over 12%. But as I say, we monitor that on a daily basis, and we have it across, so you can have disproportionate impacts depending on outbreaks in different prisons. So you might have much lower levels of COVID-related absence in a few prisons and much higher in others, just depending on what's happening in the localities and or what's happening in those establishments at that time. With regards to our staffing levels, we are sitting... because we continued our recruitment practice and that was moved to online recruitment, we have been able to maintain quite a positive staffing position. So at the most recent figures I received, I think we were just slightly above what our normal staffing level should sit at, certainly for operational staff.
Okay, thanks very much for that. I'm going to bring in Rona Mackay. You want to ask a quick
supplementary just on the earlier part of my colleague's question to Alistair Purdy. The information the request you get from governors to implement measures and then your subsequent permission, if that's what's happened, and is all that made public? No.
No, at this point it's not. It's held within the Scottish Prison Service.
Right. So, okay, so the committee wouldn't know what measures were being implemented in any particular prison?
No, but the independent prison monitors have access to that within the prison, as same as Wendy Sinclair-Gibbons' team as well would have access to that at any time about how many people were in isolation and what restrictions had been applied by specific governors or establishments.
Mm-hmm. Is that something the committee could find out? You know, if we wrote to, you know, if we wrote to prisons and asked them what's...
Yeah. Yes.
But it doesn't automatically come from yourself to be in the public realm?
No, not at this point, no.
Okay, thank you.
Thanks, okay, thanks very much. I'm just going to go... Okay, Jamie, just come in.
Precisely as it's a follow-up to Ron Mackay's question, the Her Majesty's Inspectorate is quoted as saying that this has been a long-term pandemic and HMIPS would like to see those powers were used, reported on transparently and regularly with clear and sufficient justification. So the inspectorate is asking for more transparency in reporting. We're clearly asking for it as well. But I get the impression that your response is that all that information is there if somebody wants it. So it doesn't seem like a joined up approach in terms of how can we make that a much more proactive issue. They might address the needs of everyone.
It's been information, Mr. Green, that we have published on our website, and I think we're publishing it on a weekly basis. And clearly, as with everything, as you move through different circumstances and different arrangements, you start to refine and hone what you're able to provide. Our systems, though, our prisoner record systems, don't allow us to look historically back at cases necessarily, so it would be quite high-level information that we would be able to provide. But certainly if the committee wanted us to write and provide you with information, then we can do that. But taking on the point Emma made earlier around the transparency, we are looking at our management information and how much we provide on our website, because we know we need to improve. And we do need to become much more transparent around the types of information that people frequently request and is of interest. But it is work in progress as we speak.
And I guess from a practical point of view, most likely for the families of those who are in specific prisons would want to know what the current status is, I guess, which would be helpful for them. But I guess my other question is there seems to be, from the response we've had, support for an extension 6 months to the temporary to the SSI to be extended. But can I just ask why 6 months? Is that just in keeping with what Parliament is doing with coronavirus measures? And it seems to be that if, for example, if the Parliament is legislating to end coronavirus measures for the, you know, for the wider public, why there's still a need for them to be extended. What's so different about the prison environment where you need to keep extending them by 6 months when we, for example, are ending them or don't really see the need to extend them for that long? And do you think you'll be coming back in another 6 months asking for them again? I know we don't know what's happened with the virus, but it seems like an endless iteration of what were only just temporary powers 2 years ago.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. No, I understand the concerns that you've raised. I think, though, if we go back to March 2020, when we first went into lockdown, most of us probably hoped that it was going to be for a few weeks, and 2 years later, almost, we're still experiencing the effects of the pandemic. I suppose the main crux of the response to your question has to be around the uniqueness of our environments. And the nature of the potential for infection spread. Also, I think the health vulnerabilities of those in our care. They do come from some of the most deprived areas in Scotland, and therefore we're particularly and acutely aware of the vulnerabilities within our population. We don't have the information around, because it's such a transient population, then vaccination status, etc., it would be really difficult to collate any kind of data that would be helpful in determining how and when we would lift completely restrictions in prisons. But we have applied, and I'd like to reassure the committee on this point, we have applied learning from each phase of the pandemic to try and make improvements as we've moved along. And so the intention would be, yet again, is to look to see what learning can we take from the recent outbreaks, and therefore what is likely to be a steady state for prisons going forward, because that's where I would like to be as well.
Thank you, Convener.
Okay, thank you very much indeed. Russell, I'll bring you in now.
Yes, thank you. It's a message for Emma, and it's just going back to what you were talking about earlier on. I appreciate your diplomatic language of euphemisms and around words like tensions and so on. Now, in respect of your concerns about the consultation process, in the letter that we have in front of us, you say that the concern is that this may be more of an administrative than a truly consultative exercise. I suppose the question is that a one-off frustration, or is this a more general cultural issue with some government agencies that you encounter?
In this instance, I think there has been a worry that it has been an administrative exercise right from the start of the pandemic with regard to the prison rules. We've written to the committee on three different occasions, highlighting the fact that first of all, nobody was consulted on the prison rules. Then there was a limited consultation of 9 organisations, of which 3, ourselves included, submitted a response due to some administrative oversight. You as a committee didn't see our full consultation response. This time we've had a matter of days in order to respond to this, and the SSI is going to be laid on Friday. It does feel as if the consultation isn't as open as it should be. The previous consultation request, SPS responded to it saying that no action would be taken on any of the points made by any of the organisations who had submitted responses. I hesitate to use this phrase because it sounds a little heavy-handed, but there has been a criticism that SPS has been allowed to mark its own homework, and that does concern us.
Thank you. I think I'll add administrative oversight to the list of euphemisms, but that's very helpful. Thank you.
Okay, that you?
Thank you. Okay,
thank you. Fullerton, you want to ask? Katie?
Yes, thank you. Teresa, you say that you have limited historical records and limited records in relation to individuals, but in the letter from the Howard League, it says that in other prison services, for example, Ireland, figures are provided for numbers of hours out of cell each day, for example. Going forward, what would you need to do to be able to provide the public and this committee with the kind of data that we probably would find very helpful for us to be able to make informed decisions?
So thanks very much for that, Ms Clark. So the data that I said was limited is in relation to historic data on individual cases, and it's hard to aggregate that. But we do collate data on purposeful activity hours, and that's published as part of our annual report and accounts, because that is something which we are scrutinised for as an organisation. So there is data and information that we have and that we can provide and we can publish. There is more that we need to do around management information and provide assurances around our management information. So we need to become more sophisticated. And as I said earlier to Mr Green, this is a journey we're on at the moment as an organisation, because I would want to be seen to be transparent and open to scrutiny rather than closed.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah, I suppose really it's what would you need to do? What do you need to do to be able to do that? What, is it resources? Is it that you don't have the resources? Is it that you don't have the systems?
Partly it is systems, and we are updating our systems as we are going through the current pandemic. But part of it as well, I think, is just becoming more sophisticated around data capture and utilising better platforms to do that. So that's why, you know, in terms of management information, identifying how best to capture that without it being resource intensive, which it is at the moment, but we do still capture a lot of data and a lot of information is published, probably not as much as people would either want or expect.
Okay, thanks, Katie. Pauline, would you like to come in with anything? No. Okay, thanks very much. There's just one follow-up, final question that I would like to ask. It just came into my mind when we've been asking questions. And it's probably one for Teresa and Alistair, and it's just about whether or not there is scope within a prison setting for there to be different levels of restrictions imposed in different parts of the prison. And forgive me if that's already been covered off and I've perhaps missed it, but rather than just having a blanket imposition of restrictions depending on the circumstances at that point in time, is there scope for different levels to be applied, or is that overly complicated?
No, in order to ensure that it is proportionate, it is only applied in the way in which it's necessary to limit the risk of the spread of the infection. So it can be applied to one cohort of individuals, and it would be quite unusual for it to be applied across a whole prison. So yes, there are flexibilities within that, and it would be expected that any governor who recommends restrictions are imposed does so by assessing the impact and doing so in conjunction with advice from the IMT.
I don't know if you want to add anything.
No, just to concur with that, that's exactly what we do. We control it by households and make sure that it's proportionate and there's no other impact in the establishment where it's not unnecessary.
Perfect. Thank you very much. Okay, that concludes our session. Again, thank you very much indeed for attending. Of course, if there are any outstanding points that you maybe want to share with the committee in writing, please feel free to do so, and we'll take that into account. So many thanks again for attending, and we'll just take a very short pause to allow you to leave the committee room. Thank you. So our next item of business is consideration of correspondence on the photocopying of prisoners' mail, and I refer members to paper 4. Members will recall that back in January we considered a statutory instrument to change prison rules to allow for the photocopying of prisoners' mail in order to mitigate against the risk of illicit substances being introduced via the mail system. And we subsequently wrote to Police Scotland, the Scottish Government and the Scottish Prison Service requesting additional information. Responses have now been received and they have been circulated with this week's committee papers. So the committee is invited to consider what, if any, follow-up action is required, and members will recall that the Cabinet Secretary for Justice and Veterans indicated that he would update the committee about the ongoing review of the regulations after a period of 3 months. So I'm happy to open up for members' views on this matter, and I'll hand straight over to Russell.
Thank you. First of all, I think the letter from the police is very reassuring. It answers the unanswered question about stuff that might be contaminated being returned to prisoners, and they're saying quite clearly that will no longer happen. Obviously, we can't really measure very much until we've heard back from the Cabinet Secretary after 3 months. But this MOU is still a bit unclear as to when it was introduced. There's no date on it. There's no Crown signatory on it. And I think it's probably just worth asking the Crown, did they indeed ever sign it? And if so, when? Okay. And I find it slightly odd that even if they did, it's at least 9 years old. And in that time, we've seen the rise of psychoactive substances. We've seen drones come along. We've seen the impregnating of male with these substances. So the whole world, the whole landscape changed. Mm-hmm. And this document is very much written predating all that stuff. So if it was it implemented, and if so, why has it not been looked at for the best part of a decade?
Okay. Thank you. Fulton?
No, I'm quite happy with what's been said. I think what we need to do is bring in the Cabinet Secretary get his update after 3 months. When it's in such a time to be in place. So I would go. I'm quite happy with that timescale.
Okay, thank you, Jamie.
Just the correspondence from the SPS in response to our questions to them. The figures, my understanding is, they only gave us figures for the 4 weeks following the changes to the rules on the 13th of December. So obviously we would request an ongoing update because that's just one month of data. And also that would have been a month of data through the Christmas period as well, where there's abnormal volumes. But it is quite notable that 48% of correspondence was photocopied and passed on. Now, I don't know if that's good or bad, actually, because I guess there was an understanding that all mail would have been photocopied, and others thought it would have been selective, depending on risk evaluation. So it's just hard to gauge whether that's a good, bad or indifferent. And maybe some context around that would be helpful. More interestingly, though, is the figures of how many of those were actually tested positive. And 12% of mail that went through the rapid scan machine actually did test positive. Mm-hmm. So it sounds like a wise move on all our parts to push for this. But I'd also really be keen to see, as we move forward over the months, as to the effect that it's having on the number of items. The number of items which are testing positive, whether that's going down as people are reducing the risk taking of sending substances in that way. But equally, it's safe to say, and I think it would be naive to think that means that drugs are being eliminated from prisons. So in that case, will there be a substantive change to the type of drug or the method of getting the drugs into prison? And that's something I think it's probably too early to say, so I appreciate the government needs more time on that. Mm-hmm. But when we do hear from them, perhaps before summer recess, it'd be interesting to see if those in the illicit sector have found new and innovative ways of getting drugs into prisons, and indeed what those drugs are. Because as we know over the years, as Russell said, that has changed by method and product. And it's fair to say that will continue to be the case. So something I think we should keep a watching eye on thereof.
Okay, thank you. Colette, would you like to come in?
Well, with reviewing it again in 3 months' time to get a full idea of the impact it's had. That said, we did discuss, and I'm not sure if it's been addressed or not, it's notwithstanding the mail being, you know, photocopied, but was delivery of personal items as well, and if that has had any... if there's been a review on that, really, and is there any suggestion that there is stuff coming in via, like, footwear and whatnot as well. So, yeah. But I am very much comfortable with the 3-month review.
Okay, thank you very much, Colette. Katie?
And to ask, I'm quite happy with review in 3 months.
Okay, thank you. Pauline?
Same here.
Okay, thank you.
And here.
Yep. Mm-hmm. Okay, thank you. Thanks very much for that. I mean, a few, I think we're probably agreed that broadly the direction of travel looks reasonably positive, but it's very early days in terms of sort of assessing or evaluating success or otherwise. The issues with the MOU, I think we can certainly follow that up in writing with Police Scotland. Fulton, you mentioned bringing the Cabinet Secretary back in, which we will do, obviously, in the 3-month timescale that we agreed or that he offered. I think perhaps continued monitoring, some evaluation of the process and how it's working. And Colette raised an interesting point about personal items. So I think it seems as though we're sort of agreed that broadly this has been a positive development and a positive piece of work. So if members are happy with that, our clerks can pick up some of those actions and take them away. So thanks very much for that. And that now concludes the public part of the meeting, and we'll now move into private session for the other items on our agenda. Thank you.